I learned that when I post a photo, I get very anxious about how many people are interacting with it in the first minute, how many are now after 10 minutes. So I've taken a few steps about it. And I mean, one could say, why don't you just delete the app? And it can be very difficult for specifically people my age, because this is a way of life right now.
Welcome to the Healthy Screen Habits Podcast. I'm Hillary Wilkinson. Whether you're starting your parenting journey with a newborn or looking to connect with your teen on technology, let's learn some new healthy screen habits together. Live More Screen Less is a Minnesota-based organization using best practices from education, public health, and positive youth development to engage with families, schools, and organizations, all in the interest of promoting balanced and intentional use of technology. So we all know I am all about internal and external balance. I've been missing my yoga practice lately, and I'm all out of kilter. I also firmly believe in living all areas of life with intention, especially surrounding technology and healthy screen habits. So one of the cool things about Live More Screen Less is they have a youth council. And I'm so excited today. We have the president of this council. Welcome to the Healthy Screen Habits podcast, Cece Hawley.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here.
Yay. I'm so glad we connected. As a third year student, what looks like maybe a few majors do you have?
Yes. Yeah. I'm double majoring in French, Spanish, and psychology with a minor in global engagements.
Oh my gosh. Yes. So you've got multiple majors and a minor, plus you've got two jobs on campus, I saw, and president of the youth council. I'm like amazed you have time to breathe. So
sometimes me too.
So let's spend just a minute having you explain a little bit more in detail what Live More Screen Less is. Like, how did it all come to be?
Yeah, it's actually a really great origin story. I was approached by KK Myers and Marie back in 2020 of March, I believe, or April. So before anything about the pandemic, and they came and approached me asking if I'd be interested in promoting this thing called digital well-being. And I had no idea what it was. I was very interested in getting involved because the way that they described it to me was that the mission was to promote balance of technology, all driven by the youth. So what really made it important to me is that it was being driven by my peers and myself, and not something that's being more commanding from an adult standpoint. So when I heard about this, I thought it was a great idea. It wasn't a fully fledged idea yet, but I wanted to get on board. And one of my friends was also part of it. So we were the first two youth council members, and it started to grow with a few more peers from different schools and ranging backgrounds. And it came to a point where I kind of stepped up as a leader and became the president of the youth council, where I would basically just serve as a liaison between the co-founders and the other youth council members, working on projects such as making slide decks, joining video calls, talking with senators. But that's pretty much an abbreviated version of the origin story.
Okay, great. So do you guys, do you collaborate with other schools, or is it specific to the university that you're at?
Actually, we collaborate mostly with high schoolers. So I just happen to be in college now. I did join in high school. And the idea that it finally turned into was promoting digital well-being through a program. So I've been certified by taking, I believe, three-hour-long sessions, learning about the physical well-being, the mental, cognitive, social well-being, and its connection to technology. And with that, now that I'm certified, I can go into other high schools and kind of put that into a curriculum, which is one of the big things that I was able to help gain, is we were able to secure $1 million of funding from the government to kind of upstart this program.
Excellent. Awesome. Okay. So this season I'm doing this like focus on social media, and part of the reason why I really wanted to chat with you and get your take on it is because as a Gen Zer, I kind of feel like you are all on the ins and outs of social media. And after this break, we'll hear all about it. US listeners, listen up. There are two Senate bills that would provide the most robust new online protections for children in nearly 25 years, and they are now at a pivotal moment. We need your help to help get them passed. The Kids Online Safety Act, or COSA, and the Children and Teens Online Privacy Protection Act, or COPA, have the potential to make the digital world much safer for young people by banning surveillance advertising to children, holding big tech accountable for exploiting kids through bad design, and more. Earlier this year, the bills were advanced by Senate Commerce Committee and now have the potential to be voted on by the full Senate before midterm elections in November. That's where you come in. We need you to call your senators, email your senators for support in these essential bills. Urge your senators to push these bills to the finish line and vote yes to support and protect American kids and teens from big tech's exploitive business model. Cece Hawley is the president of the Live More, Screen Less Youth Council, a group that's brimming over with creativity and passion for creating a world of digital well-being for all. So, Cece, there is so much news in the news, rather, about social media, how it can harm teenage girls, but also like how it can build community, but mostly how it's lacking guardrails to protect young people. And I feel like your generation is truly patient zero on the social media front, like for better or for worse. It's just how it worked out. So I think if we could like kind of back it up, and I just like to take it from this kind of like huge perspective of you're talking to, you know, you're fundraising millions of dollars, you're speaking with senators. And I just would like to kind of like bring it right down to you and back up for a minute and ask, how old were you when you first started a social media account?
I got my first phone as a fourth grader. It was a flip phone, so it was pretty much only texting and calling my parents. When I did move into more of a middle school phase, I believe like sixth grade, fifth grade is when I did start my Instagram account. I had an older sister and she is about 2 years older. So she kind of was already in that realm with using social media. And my first social media account was Instagram. And going into that at a young age, you really don't know what it is. And also, I don't think anyone at the time knew how big of a thing it would be. So I was probably around sixth grade when I first got it.
Okay. So in the house that you grew up in, what was kind of like the vibe around tech? Did you guys have rules, or was it, it sounded like you had an older sibling. Were you guys figuring it out together? Like what was the structure around it in your house?
I think the general trend that I've always seen with adults in my life, has been they don't know what the rules and boundaries should be. So at the time, it really wasn't anything for me. And I, thankfully, it wasn't a huge issue per my own individual, but I have seen it affect my siblings a lot with the way that they use technology. And I can even see it in like schools with the way that we literally had iPads and laptops in my school, and there's still not many boundaries written down because no one really knows what it's like to have everyone having a social media account and technology.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's all become very conflicted with all these, you know, the different platforms and streaming and everything else. And so I'm just wondering, I feel conflicted about social media because there are parts of it that I love. There are parts of it that allow us to instruct and educate and build awareness and things like that. And then there are other things that I deeply wish would go away. And so I'm kind of wondering, like, from a Gen Zer perspective, what are your views on social media? Like, how do you feel about it?
Mm-hmm. As I've grown older, it's definitely been more of a nuanced thing for me. At a certain point, I thought it was completely negative, and at a certain point, I thought it was super positive. Right now, I think it is more in the conflicted realm, just because I do enjoy seeing what my friends are up to. I do enjoy kind of having my own place where I can post and show what I've been up to. There's obviously negative aspects that affect me, and I've tried to take steps to help out with it, such as I have the setting where you can't see how many numbers of likes you have. And I also have the setting of my notification for Instagram turned off, because I learned that when I post a photo, I get very anxious about how many people are interacting with it in the first minute, how many are now after 10 minutes. So I've taken a few steps about it. And I mean, one could say, why don't you just delete the app? And it can be very difficult for specifically people my age, because this is a way of life right now.
Sure. With
communicating, learning about things. I mean, every single club on campus has an Instagram account to show about events. Mm-hmm. So I would say it's far more difficult than just deleting it.
Oh, for sure. I mean, people run whole businesses off of it. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, so I think it's become this thing that is far greater than anybody ever dreamed a photo sharing app. And then that's only Instagram. Like, do you have Snapchat as well?
I do. I'm very involved with many social media apps. So I have Snapchat. I have the new one that's called Be Real. I'm not sure if you've heard about it.
Yes.
And I do even consider LinkedIn as its own social media platform.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. No, one could argue that any user generated content is social media. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that includes YouTube, or, yeah. You know, so it's, yeah. So that's interesting. Okay. So let's talk about influencers, because I find this very interesting, this kind of delineation between what, like, can you define for me, because I can't figure out what makes an account like popular versus what makes an influencer account. So I guess I'm looking for a definition, because I don't know. And I'm wondering if you could shed some light.
That's definitely a good question. It's making me think a little bit more. Probably for a definition of what makes an account an influencer account would just be a larger following. A larger following that can affect many different people. Like, I would never say I'm an influencer with, number one, the amount of people that I interact with on social media and the reach that it gets. For example, with TikTok, with people who have the algorithm where they're able to post something and it immediately goes out to millions of people and they start growing and growing more, I would say that's obviously an influencer. But I'm not sure if that's an entire definition, but that's what I have for you right now.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's interesting, because it seems like there's this shift that goes from like popular, that goes from popular account. And then my definition, when somebody asked me about it, was I thought it was like the point at which maybe their content started becoming monetized.
Mm.
But I don't even know if that's accurate. So I thought I would ask someone like you.
I think it's a really great border there. It's just difficult now that there's so many different like sides of social media, where like there's influencers who cook or influencers who talk about movies. It's just difficult when,
yeah,
like some of them aren't monetized, but they have a large following and influence so many people.
Right, right. So maybe that's just, that's why I needed to talk to you, because I'm trying to apply my Gen Xer values of like, well, it needs to be a money-making platform. Okay. So someone like you, you're clearly, I mean, highly involved at a university, et cetera, et cetera. That being said, do you think that influencing is becoming more acceptable as a career choice?
I do think so, in the way that it's just becoming more normalized. I from the way that I've talked with a lot of my peers here, I think a lot of them feel the same way, in that it's it makes sense that you can make money, so why wouldn't you do that? But none of them are ever, like, I would say, chasing for that type of job or career choice, at least the circles that I'm surrounded by. But I do think it's definitely become more acceptable and more understood compared to what it was like 2 years ago, even.
Sure. I mean, it's been fast, right? I mean, everything about the pandemic just was kerosene on tech for doing video calls to everything. I mean, prior to the pandemic, I think I'd been on maybe a few video calls, and now it's like the only thing we ever do. So
exactly. And it's just so interesting to see, because I think a lot more kids are growing up with the idea of that being a career choice, or maybe an aspiration even, and seeing how that's affecting like my younger siblings. I'm not saying that they want to be influencers. I don't believe they do, but just the way that influencers have that effect on kids, the way that most influencers are in their young 20s doing lots of things, being able to buy lots of clothes, and seeing that affect my younger siblings dressing in a way that I never did at that age, because they have that access to other adult people to look up to.
Right. Right. Yeah. So yeah, there's never kind of like, you know, I'm going to use the phrase better teacher, but that's not, I'm not like putting a value on that term better. I'm just saying like, there is no teacher for kids than a kid or someone, you know, young adult that's just a little bit older than them. Mm-hmm. And I feel like every parent would know what I'm talking about. Somehow like an 8-year-old could teach my 6-year-old how to tie their shoe way better than I could, you know, after, even though I tried and tried and tried, and all it took was like one child coming who was just a little bit older than them. It's like they speak a different language. So 100%. Yeah. So knowing this, it's also, I'm totally recognizing that this is like your current superpower, because
exactly that it has a lot of merit to it. I mean, I think that's a huge reason why I was interested in Live More and being that youth advisor, because I've already noticed it with my siblings again, like they can hear more coming from someone closer in age.
Totally. Totally. So how do you, knowing that, and knowing we don't have you in our back pockets all over the country here, how do you recommend talking to our kids about like sensitive subjects, like explicit content or creepy people, you know, I mean, clearly predators, but I mean, without, how do you recommend approaching those topics without them kind of just being like, ugh, mom?
Yeah, that's a really, really good question, because I can remember back in the day when I was a kid too, me saying back in the day, but being a few years ago, but it's hard to reach that balance. And I think the largest thing is just being really, really candid and saying, I understand that this is a time where so many people connect through texting, connect through social media, but truly there are steps you need to take to be safe. And if that, we have trust for you and we want to trust you, but remember that at any point, if you step over that line, we need to take precautions to keep you safe. I think as a kid, just knowing that I am trusted, but also knowing that I need to be safe for myself, because it can be a fun thing, but also a very scary thing. Knowing that there is a boundary there and knowing that my parents do have my back, I think would be the best way to go about it.
Okay. That's good advice. Just so any of our Healthy Screen Habits listeners are clear, we do not believe, I know that this may not reflect Cece's views at all. So I'm going out on a limb here, but we at Healthy Screen Habits do not believe that any middle schooler belongs on social media. So we firmly believe on waiting for social media. When we come back, I'm going to ask Cece for her healthy screen habit.
Are you looking to get your child a phone but don't know where to start? Good news. Healthy Screen Habits has done the legwork for you, and our answer is Gab Wireless. Gab Wireless created the phone that parents have all been asking for. It can text but doesn't receive or send pictures. It looks like a smartphone with a touchscreen, has talk, text, calculator, calendar, FM radio, and alarm functions, but no internet. Setup is super easy. plug it in and start charging. Activation is free, shipping is free, and the best news is that Gab wireless phones start at under $100. Now, even more good news. You can get $5 off your order of a Gab wireless phone by using the promo code HSHABITS. That's HS Habits, like healthy screen habits, but short. You can find a link to Gab Wireless under the Tools tab on our website at www.healthyscreenhabits.org. Press and hold the tab menu and look under products we endorse in the drop-down menu.
My guest today is the president of the Live More Screen Less Youth Council. She speaks three languages and her favorite dessert is chocolate cake. So speaking of dessert, this is the last little bit of each episode. That's just that. It's the part that you kind of get to enjoy and hopefully employ a few in your own life. Cece, as you know, on each episode, I ask my guest for a healthy screen habit. This is a tip or a takeaway that people can put into use in their own home. Do you have one for us today?
I do. In general, I think it's one of those things where you are using social media or anything for your own joy. I think if something isn't giving you joy, if a photo does give you joy, you should post it. And if it doesn't give you joy, delete it. I think it's one of those things you just have to always remind yourself that these things were created for you, and it's up to you to take your steps on how to reclaim that and make sure that it's adding to your joy rather than taking away.
Yeah. I like it's that maintenance of that intentional purpose that you guys kind of circle back again and again to. So I thought your healthy screen habit reflected that. So as always, a complete transcript of this episode, as well as links to any of the resources mentioned, can be found in today's show notes. You can find these on the healthyscreenhabits.org. Click on the podcast button and use the drop-down menu to find this episode. Cece, thank you so much for being here today. And thank you even more for the important work that you're doing as part of the Youth Council and all of the education that you're giving to kids just a little bit younger than you, because we all know they're going to listen to you a lot more.
Thank you so much for having me.
For more information, you can find us on Instagram and Facebook at Healthy Screen Habits. Make sure to visit our website, healthyscreenhabits.org, where you can subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts or via RSS so you'll never miss an episode. It's free, it's fun, and you get a healthy new screen habit each week. While you're at it, if you found value in this show, we'd appreciate you giving us a quick rating. It really does help other people find us and spread the word of Healthy Screen Habits. Or if you'd simply like to tell a friend, we'd love that too. I so appreciate you spending your time with me this week, and I look forward to learning more healthy habits together.